Hey, it's Fran again in the lab with a sort of continued video about a video I made a few weeks ago called The AI Art Apocalypse, where I talked about the impending doom of illustrators and writers to bots. Lots of comments, and I stand by everything that I said in that video, but I did want to go a little further. Because when I talked about the image-making bots that were making ridiculous images at this point, but very captivating, optimized images that are designed to captivate the human viewer because the bot knows exactly what people tend to like to see, and I made the argument that's going to put illustrators out of work in the future. Not right now, but in the future. Particularly as they get better at doing moving images and such, we're going to be entering into a very dangerous and unknown territory, but I digress. The biggest comment that I took umbrage with to that video was so many people saying some version of, oh yeah, they said that photography would kill painting, and that didn't happen, right? Well, no, it absolutely did. Photography did kill painting as an industry, completely. Oh, wait a second. People still paint. There's paint. You go to a museum, there's paintings. You know, there's all these paintings. You know, paintings didn't go away. Okay, so let me make this clear. Before the age of photography in the late 19th century, there was an industry, not arts and crafts, not hobbies, but there was an industry in painting portraits. Before the age of photography, there were two main kinds of painting that was done professionally. People who earned their living painting. There were people who painted the huge decorative mural type pieces that were made for the aristocracy that would take up an entire wall, these mammoth depictions of life and nature and all kinds of different kinds of scenes. The styles changed throughout decades and decades, but for centuries, these enormous paintings, that was like the bread and butter for an entire industry of artists trying to fulfill the desire for these huge scenes to occupy the rooms of people who could afford them. That and the extremely lucrative industry of portraiture, because people needed a portrait done of themselves, of their family, and not just one, because as people got older, they would want different portraits done of them at different ages. When they got a new member of the family, they would want portraits done. When family members died, they would have portraits done of the corpse. It was all a very lucrative industry of artists who sustained themselves doing this work throughout their adult lives, and it was sustainable. People always needed another portrait. And painters would, they would often travel around because in the rural areas they didn't have portrait artists. And many portrait artists, even naive painters who had no classical training and had no real art instruction behind them, they would travel through the countryside and do portraiture of people in small villages and such for working class money, and sometimes work just for barter and such. But it was a way that you, as an artist, could make a living. And all that changed with photography. It began in the 1840s with daguerreotypes, because daguerreotypes, they were invented by Louis Daguerre in 1839. And daguerreotypes were small. They were little copper plates that were coated with a thin coating of silver that was polished to a mirror finish, and then a chemical was applied so that it would be photoreactive, and then when exposed with an image in a camera obscura, it would create a chemical reaction which then could be brought out with dangerous processes like vaporized mercury. And it created a change in the molecular surface of the silver and created a negative image which would look positive if you viewed it upon reflection. If you reflected the light off of the daguerreotype, it would look like positive. Daguerreotypes, they were expensive and dangerous to do, But they began the death knell to a very entrenched industry of miniature portrait painters that existed in Europe and in the United States back in the 18th century and into the 19th century. And miniature portraits, they were so desirable because they were portable and they required immense skill and patience, and they could be expensive. And miniature portrait artists, again, this was an industry. It wasn't craft. It wasn't the kind of abstract expression that would come after photography. But the daguerreotype was the first salvo, the warning shot for the death of portraiture. In the 1850s, wet collodion photography began to replace daguerreotypes, and you know, by the end of the 1850s, daguerreotypes were just gone, and it was all wet collodion. In fact, my friend C.J. Harker made some wet collodion plates, which I did a video about, and I managed to sit for the camera. This is one of the wet collodion plates that CJ made for me. It's a painstaking process. I'll put a link in the description that shows the whole thing. But just like daguerreotypes, it's actually like a negative. You have to put it in front of a dark background to be able to see the image. Let's see. Yeah. But this was the second shot. Wet collodion photography was portable, it was quick to do, and the exposure times were lower than daguerreotypes, and so it was another warning to portraiture. But it had limits because it had to be done to scale, and it had to be presented in a certain way, and it was not a replacement for a portrait. But that was going to change a little later. In the 1870s, with silver gelatin prints, it was now possible to make a positive on paper from the negative with a contact exposure, and now high resolution, very good definition paper photographs were being produced, and it completely decimated the industry of portraiture. Portraiture went from an industry of artists who were making their living doing that to a complete erasure of that industry. Portraiture after the 1870s became something that was done just for the very rich and not nearly on the scale that it was done before photography. And curiously enough, all of the kinds of art that people today would consider painting, pop art, impressionist, cubist, abstract, all of the art that you would see in a modern art museum, the kind of painting that when people think of painting, that's what they think of. All these forms of expression and painting were created as a result of the destruction of the industry of portraiture caused by photography. And now you may say, well, so what, Fran? You see, I mean, painting was fine. People just painted differently. It was fine. It was the change from a sustainable industry that employed people who could work for a living, which was portraiture, to a realm of painting as a form of artistic expression, which very few people, very, very, very few people, could ever make a living at. People want to think of 20th century painters like Picasso and say that, well, this is the thing, you know, Picasso made a fortune, Dali did really great. For every Dali or Picasso, there were tens of thousands of Van Goghs who painted and died without making a single cent. And all those paintings which were on museum walls, so highly lauded and selling for so many millions of dollars, they weren't bought back when they were painted, because almost all those painters, those late 19th century, early 20th century painters, so many of them languished in poverty, unable to make a living selling their art. Yeah, so when I talk about the implications to illustrators and to writers, the only people who aren't concerned about it are the people who don't actually make a living writing for a living or illustrating for a living. But illustrators and writers are very worried about bots, because the day-to-day rudimentary, paid work that's done by illustrators to illustrate for books, articles, you know, things on the internet, print, even caricatures. These are the kinds of things that in the very near future the bots are going to get very good at, good enough to replace all of those paid jobs with things that anyone can just dial up for free and put on their blog, dial up for free, put in their article, dial up for free, put in their magazine. Rather than employing illustrators, they're just going to have bots to do that work. And writers who have to write copy for a living, I'm talking about novelists, although AI certainly will write very good novels, but people who make their living writing, it tends to be, you know, everyday doodah work that kind of disappears, you know, corporate writing, writing for textbooks. These are the kinds of things that people are going to be replaced with bots. Imagine a world where children are instructed from electronic textbooks that are written by bots, where people get all of their education from scrolls of text that are written by bots, where people get all of their artistic enjoyment looking at images that are created by bots, in a world where motion pictures, movies, television shows are going to be created entirely by artificial intelligence, where moving images are going to be created by bots. We're talking about 5, 10, 15 years in the future, where virtually every kind of media that we consume, it's going to be much cheaper to generate those things with a machine than to pay a person a living wage to do it. And then people say, oh, France, give me management. Humans will manage it, bots will create it. Well, that's fine, but just like every other factory, you have one person managing the work that would have formerly employed 100 people. So yes, the argument that photography didn't kill painting is bogus. It did kill painting. It killed painting as a lucrative industry, as a way to make a living. And it transformed painting from an industry into a craft where a handful of people got rich doing it and everyone else did not. And that is what AI is going to do to painters and writers in the very near future. And I'll drop the mic on that. And so that's it. Thanks for watching. Thanks to all my patrons down on the Patreon. Real human beings. Wouldn't be able to do any of this without my real human patrons on Patreon making all of these videos possible. Thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone on Patreon. So I'll be back here at the bench doing something else scientific real soon. Well, at least while I can afford to, until the bots replace me and FranLab will be done by AI. We'll see. I'm Fran. Bye!
Work. Yeah.